Thanks very much for inviting me here. It's a great crowd. Okay, so I will speak about our project on simulating the life cycle of molecular clouds, as Romain just said. This is the list of people who are mostly involved. We are 10 in total, and I will mention them in between the talk, because as I go through the different physics which is involved here, then you will see who did what. Okay, so Patrick just gave a very nice introduction for the regime where basically we form stars from cold and dense clumps, so molecular clouds, and well, every so often we happen to form a massive star, and that starts to affect its environment by ionizing radiation, stellar winds, and later on supernova explosions. And so if you want to make the connection between the galactic scale and star formation in galaxies and local star formation and feedback, you basically have to go through the whole process where you form dense molecular clouds on scales of maybe a kiloparsec or so. You fragment there, you have a multiphase interstellar medium, which is hot, warm, cold, molecular. So many different phases, different physical processes which come into play. And then, so you have to go down all the way to AU scales where you form the stars. And later on, especially when once you have supernova explosions, you go back up to the galactic scale and affect huge volumes in the disk, up to a few hundred parsecs. And so basically, putting all of this together is really necessary in order to understand the whole life cycle of gas in our galaxies. And I think right now we are at a point where we are able to put all these individual simulations together into one big thing, and that's what we were trying to do in this project. So the SILC project, simulating the life cycle of molecular clouds, has been established last year. The first simulation we did was the local. And so basically there's Munich involved, also Heidelberg, Ralf Klaassen, Simon Glauber, Paul Clark, and Christian Baczynski, and in Prague, Richard Wünsch, who's done a great job on the tree self-gravity, and also in Zurich we have Thomas Peters. And we got 42 million core hours to run these simulations, and this is the first time I ever show a picture with me in a supercomputer. Okay. So let me go through and tell you in more detail what kind of physics we involve in SILC. So basically we took flash, maybe it wasn't the best choice, we took it because we all had experience with it. It's an AMR code. We implemented mixed boundary conditions. Well, they are already mixed boundary conditions, but for self-gravity we had to modify it. Speaking of self-gravity, we're using the tree self-gravity, which was implemented there by Richard Wünsch, and it's official in the latest release. However, we changed it, improved it to take into account different opening angle criteria, which actually speed up the whole problem by a huge factor. And we also implemented new ways, not new ways, but known ways of error control, but like for example, the Simon and Warren priority queue and stuff like that, so to have a better error control in the gravity. And we need that because we needed to use the tree because we also implemented something called tree coil, which we'll speak on later on, basically a way to treat diffuse radiation and self-shielding, which is very necessary for molecule formation. And I will show you a plot which basically shows that. So then we also have external gravitational potential. The framework for this was already in flash, but we had to make it work together with the self-gravity because that's not what it was made for. So it took one or the other, but not both of them. And then we have IDEAL-MHD, the Pursue 5 wave solver, reported to flash 4. There's also an unsplit staggered mesh, but for that you need a lot more memory, and that is an issue, as I will tell you later. And then we have heating and cooling and molecule formation through the chemical network by Simon Glover. I put that into flash together with Simon, and it works together with the tree coil algorithm to treat the self-shielding. We have sink particles, with separate cluster models in low resolution simulations. Basically, the things are treated as star clusters. In high resolution simulations, they can be treated as individual stars, and obviously only massive stars, because we cannot resolve Lyapunov stars in these models. And however, these stars have provide stellar feedback in form of stellar winds and supernovae, and we're still working on the radiation transport, which is being implemented by Christian Baczynski, our PhD student of life. Okay, so I will focus a little bit on the chemistry, because it hasn't been touched in Patrick's talk. So what we did is we used a simplified chemical network by Simon Glover. So we have the major coolants and the major heating processes to go through the whole ISM temperature regime between 10 Kelvin or 7 Kelvin up to 10 to the 7, 10 to the 8 Kelvin. And so you can also set your abundances in the model I will show you now. We have standard solar abundances, however, this enables us to also change the metallicity of the gas. So in principle, we can look at low metallicity systems. And the numeric switches involved here means that we have an operator split approach. It's an implicit Diebold solver, which solves the chemistry on a cell basis. So it's very well suited for parallelizing it, because it really doesn't communicate between the cells. And however, it needs a lot of memory, because there are new field variables, and at the minimum for forming or following H2 and CO formation, you need 5 more field variables, which can be quite expensive. So we have here H1, so atomic hydrogen, ionized hydrogen, and molecular hydrogen, and we have ionized carbon and CO, and this is a simplified method of forming CO, where you basically form CO directly from the ionized gas phase. This is a model being published by Nelson and Lange in 1979. Okay, so then there's also a subcycling, if that is necessary, which is, it's necessary if the cooling time is short compared to the dynamical time, and so we allow for subcycling in the chemistry. And in order to follow molecule formation, well, molecules have to be shielded from the interstellar radiation field. So usually you have UV radiation coming from the outside. If you are inside a molecular cloud, you need to be deeply embedded in order to not be dissociated as a molecule. And so you need to follow that in order to follow molecule formation. And so therefore we implemented this TreeCon method in the Barnes and Hutt octal tree, which we already had. Basically, TreeCon makes use of the fact that each tree node already stores the information which is necessary for computing the column densities, which is basically only the mass. So you have the mass and you have the center of mass of the nodes, which is already stored in the tree. You also know the size of the nodes. And then what you do is, you for every cell, you span a Hilbert sphere with given resolution. Obviously you need more memory when you need more Hilbert levels. And so in every area, you compute the column density. So what we compute is actually the total column, the H2 column, the CO column, and also the dust attenuation in every one of these pixels. And then we sum them all up, we compute a mean, and from that we get the total shielding and AV, for example, which we need to give to the chemistry network and follow the molecule formation. And this is just a simple test showing that it works. So we used a uniform density sphere with one solar mass. And basically, this is showing you AV, so the optical depth as you go towards the center is increasing. And it's quite smooth, even though this is very low resolution. Okay, so now a very simple test showing you how it works. If you actually have turbulence, driven turbulence in a box, very simple setup, it's 128 parsec, an odd number, but we always have 1 parsec resolution, so it's very low resolution. And we have a typical interstellar medium. Initially, we start with 6,000 K, 3 particles per cubic centimeter, and we drive turbulence at 10 kilometers per second. And this is what it looks like. So here's slices of density, temperature, H2 abundance, and CO abundance. And, well, if you look at it, you can see that the H2 kind of follows the dense regions. So here you have high densities, and you have also a lot of H2. And also the color type is not so good, but the SCO also follows the cold regions where you have high density. And now if you do the same thing, the same run with and without pre-coil, then what you find is that so the black line is with pre-coil and the red line is without pre-coil, and this is the HQ mass fraction as a function of time, CO mass fraction as a function of time. Basically, you see that you underestimate your molecular abundance by or mass fraction by orders of magnitude if you don't include the self-shielding. So it's really important to actually do that if you want to follow molecular cloud formation in this type of multiphase ISM. And so, as I already said, tree-coil, it's not a major concern in terms of time, because if you increase self-gravity, you have to do the tree walk anyway, so you don't waste any time there. However, in terms of memory, it does request quite a lot more memory, like in all kinds of radiation transport you do, like in the normal. Okay. And I can want to go into a bit, little bit more detail here about how our tree build is working. So in principle, it's a very normal scheme. What I want to point out here is that, first of all, well, you build the tree on the leaf block, so flash is a block structure, every block has 8 cubed cells, and then you have to communicate, and then you also have to build a parent tree on all cores, otherwise you end up communicating all the time. Now, the funny thing here is that the size of that array scales with the number of maximum blocks you allow per core, but also with the number of CPUs you're using. And now if you go to a large number of CPUs, this can very quickly become a major limitation. So basically, we would need to restructure the whole thing. However, then it becomes slower because you have to communicate more. Okay. So this just to point out. In its current form, the tree scales incredibly well. So this is the speed up here for the tree solver as a function of number of CPUs. And this test was been done ages ago. That's why it actually doesn't go for higher than 512. So basically, the green line here and the pink line are showing are the speed up for the tree gravity solver. And you can see, so the black line is linear scaling. You can see that it really scales very well. This is the original implementation of the multi-grid Poisson solver in Flash. I don't know why it doesn't scale perfectly well. Probably Paul can tell me much more about this, but there's more communication involved, and it's just slower than the tree. I think that's the reason why. So, yes. Exactly. So in the end, I mean, with the tree, you really have an advantage if you go to large core numbers. However, as I said, there might be a memory issue. Otherwise, the AMR Hydro MHD scales perfectly well. This test was done on SuperMOOC at the Leibniz Rechenzentrum in Garching, where we actually do this project. So now coming back to the whole simulation, I will show you one now. So here we go. This is one of the slabs of the disk galaxies we simulate. And it is a disk which was set up with 30 solar masses per square parsec in gas surface density. And here you see slices again. This is density, this is temperature, H1 abundance, H2 abundance, and CO. And we drive turbulent supernovae in these simulations randomly in this case. So, but we can also drive them from... Oh, sorry. This is not random. This is from density peaks. I put in another version last minute. Okay. So, yeah, we have two ways of driving supernova explosions. One is just random driving, and one is where we explode the supernova in the density peaks. And so you can already see we form a very filamentary density structure, and you have supernova explosions. Every once in a while, you manage to form a very high density region, and then it becomes dense enough in order to be massive enough that there can be massive stars, and then we explode it in a supernova. And what you can see is that we have a molecular hydrogen formation in the galactic disks. We also trigger some outflow of molecular hydrogen, and that is not at all traced by CO. This slice is a bit unfortunate because actually the only CO clump which exists is moving out of it, so you can't actually see any CO anymore, but there is CO because if you look at the tidal masses, then you can get those CO. But you can see that there's still a lot of molecular hydrogen, even though there's absolutely no CO, which is interesting to begin with, because it means that there's not a constant ratio between CO and H2 throughout the galactic disk. And so this is, at these scale heights, that's what other people have seen before, so that's not really unusual. Yeah, yes, that's true. I mean, there is gas at 10 to the 5 K and so on, but you do quickly cool down to... I mean, the thing is that here the supernova rate is quite high, and so you push out a lot of gas, and therefore, as soon as you have too high densities or higher densities at higher altitudes, you also cool, right? And so basically, it's fine-tuning between how many supernovae you explode and how much gas you push out, and then what kind of scale height you get for the disk. Yes, we have a... You mean for the radiation field? Yeah, we have an interstellar radiation field that's basically solar neighborhood radiation field. And so it dissociates the H2 at high altitudes. We have it everywhere in this case. Mm-hmm. It's just dense enough. So it's cooling. Actually, the scale height of the simulation is higher than what I showed you, but I couldn't fit it on. So yes, we do. We do get outflows. And we ran models with different gas surface densities. Yes, well, okay. So therefore, we need to run the models a lot longer, like 100 megayears or so at least, in order to get it back down. And we haven't done that yet. I don't want to show many results because there's no time and it's not the focus of this meeting. I just wanted to point out this one thing. So we ran models with different surface densities, and what we find, which is in agreement with observations, is that basically the H2 mass fraction scales with the surface density of the gas disk. And so if you go to high gas surface density disks, like 500 solar masses, which is the case for high redshift disks, then you end up with a disk which can be fully molecular, basically, or a significant fraction of it is in molecular hydrogen. Okay, so now, issues with this project. There are many, I'm not going to tell you all of them, but I think the biggest issues I see are that the high-performance computing specifications are very different on different machines. And so it may take you a fairly long time to tune your code to run efficiently on one particular system as soon as you go above a few thousand coulombs. And I think this is an issue because it means that you have to restructure your code depending on what you get as a machine. And if you don't know in advance, then you might spend a lot of time or waste it or whatever and not get anything out. Load balancing in our case is not such a big issue because we refine many different regions. However, memory is a real problem, has been pointed out before by people here, especially if you do multiphysics, and you don't want to get rid of physics in order to run on exascale systems, right? You want to do all the physics on the exascale system. And so if what the situation we have with the LSZ is that there's no swap on the nodes, and so therefore there's the situation becomes even worse because there's even less memory than specified initially because it's used up to map the system into the memory. You can save memory by using slimmer compilers, and I've played around with this. So there's the Intel MPI, for example, on SuperMUC, and that needs only 60% of the resident memory and also of the virtual memory compared to IBM MPI. However, the scaling is much worse with it. And I hope I don't offend anyone, but that's my experience. And so with the current code, it's basically not possible to run on very large numbers of cores, just simply due to the memory limitations. Otherwise, our scaling would be perfectly fine. I mean, it's really, we run out of memory and so we can't do it. So we need to restructure the code on the long run. And it means that either we use less memory, so we restructure code to allocate less memory or do other tricks. However, I think we will have, we will then abandon the really nice scaling we have at the moment, and we don't know right now what the systems will look like, so that's a bit risky. The first approach I would go for is becoming fully hybrid, and that buys you at least a factor of number of cores per node. And I think for the tree, that's enough to go for from what we have now, a few thousand cores up to petascale. It won't be enough for exascale, so here we really need to do other things. So just to conclude, we have to understand how molecular clouds form in a context which basically gives you the boundary condition from the whole galaxy. That's what we need to understand galaxy formation. And this is a very complex problem which involves a lot of different physical processes at different resolutions. And so therefore we now had an attempt to develop a powerful computational tool with which we can actually do this. But at the moment, going to exascale, or at least more than a few thousand or 10,000 cores, is tricky for a lot of parts, different parts of the code. For the chemistry, it's not, because that's a process which scales perfectly well. But for other things, like for example the tree, it is. And so I think memory is our biggest issue. And I just put up this conference announcement of a very nice meeting in Greece, which we will do next year. So if you're interested, contact me. Thank you.